3, 2, 1.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to our YouTube Live session. We'll get started in about a minute as we still have some people joining.
Charlie, are you wearing your lucky shirt today?
Are you wearing the same shirt?
I am, actually. I'm wearing the same shirt for every one of these. I made a pact with myself. That's what was going to happen.
I thought so, too.
All right. Why don't we get started? Thank you, everyone, for joining. We'll do some quick intros before we dig into the session. My name is Charlie Ogden. I'm a product manager at Autodesk, and I'm focused on grading and drainage features in our infrastructure products.
I'm Val Koch. I'm a research engineer here at Autodesk, and I work mostly on grading optimization, everything optimization, but mostly grading.
John. I'm John Sayer. I'm in the technical marketing. I'm a technical marketing manager. I focus on civil infrastructure. I've had the privilege of working with these guys on grading optimization since it was not named grading optimization.
What was Ground it? Project, Force.
It was Project Ground Force, right? I honestly was kind of hoping they would leave that name. I thought that was pretty cool, but been working with them quite a while on this, and they asked me to present, so I'm going to do the presentation today.
Great. All right, so as you may see, today is session 3, or part 3 of our 6-part YouTube Ask Me Anything Live sessions. We put these together to help you learn more about grading optimization for Civil 3D. But under this video in the description, you can find links to all the sessions, including the past ones that we did, in case you missed those. And also make sure to set reminders for the upcoming sessions. We have a couple more coming up. Feel free. I see some people are already telling us where they're from. That's great. Also, you know, as we go along, ask your questions there in the chat. As John said, he'll be driving this session, so Val and I will help to answer questions in the background. And then at the end, we'll have a Q&A session if we have a lot of questions left. So take it away, John.
All right. Move that over and share my screen real quick so you guys can see my screen, correct?
Yes.
Perfect. All right. Well, thank you all for joining us today live. First thing I want to do before we jump right into grading optimization is Charlie was having just a little bit of a problem with the object viewer, and I just wanted to give him like a 10-15 second tutorial on that. You basically, if you want to look at something in 3D, you can just select that object if it has vertical elevation and drop down to object viewer, and you can twist it like this, and you can see that the relief and everything across the project. So I believe Charlie was kind of moving it and it was this way.
So yeah, once you go upside down now, I think everybody can relate. Things get a little hairy.
I told Charlie I was going to pick on him about that. So thank you folks for enduring that. All right, so we're going to get right into it. What I want to talk to you about today is detention ponds. They are near and dear to my heart. I like talking about detention. I love to talk about stormwater design and things of that nature. Hearing other folks talk about it, I absolutely love that. It's just a fun topic to me, and that makes me a little weird, I know, but that hopefully shows my excitement. So detention ponds, if you have ever had to design one, you know that there is a lot of iteration, okay? when I say iteration, change, okay? So I don't know how many pods I've done in my career, but I can tell you that I hardly ever, and I say hardly ever, maybe 1% of the time, get the actual volume I need the first time. So there's always iteration. You look at a pond, you try and use something that's standard to figure how many cubic foot of storage you need for your post-development flow. And you put that in, you factor that in, and you build the pond, and it's either too small or too big, or you don't have enough freeboard or something like that. So grading optimization does a very, very nice job of that iteration because it's so fast to do it. All right, we can change parameters. We can change slopes. We can do all of that stuff and rerun things very, very quickly. We can also gather the volumes or look at the volumes using the stage storage feature that's inside of Civil 3D. I'm going to show you some tricks to that today whenever you're looking at your volumes. So hopefully that makes sense whenever we talk about it. We have our detention pond here in this area, okay? Now, to start off, I'm not going to go through how to build this stuff, meaning these two lines or these three lines that I've got shown, these three polylines. I'm just going to jump right into it because the last two sessions, they've covered very well how and what needs to be created, okay? And they've talked through the different grading objects. It's there. So I'm going to jump right in and just start talking about just the pond specifically. All right. So I do need to do one thing here. I need to remove the pond off of that polyline. So these lines that you see, they are polylines. They're just closed 3D polylines. This polyline represents the inside of our pond, all right? And actually, it represents the outside of our pond. And this line is our grading limit. You know, if you've attended these sessions or used grading optimization at all, you have to have a grading limit for every project that you're working on. Okay, so there's a limit as to how far it needs to go out. You can have multiple grading limits. That's fine. In this particular project, we do. We have a grading limit for the grading over here, and we have a grading limit for our pond. So there's two grading limits. So first thing we need to do, and what I do want to show you, is the grading object itself that we're going to use today. Not all of them or how we built it, but the grading object itself. So I'm going to select the pond grading object, and I'll pick my pond, all right? I'll bring this over. We're going to create a dry pond first. Now, you can create wet ponds, and I believe we'll have time to show that because, you know, the volumes are a little bit different whenever you're doing a wet pond because you have a consistent water elevation that is stored inside the pond, and then your storage is on top of that. So, you'll be able to see how it returns that. You can also create a safety bench. You have an aquatic bench, things of that nature that we can talk through. So to start off today, we are going to start with a dry pond. We're going to tell it what the minimum storage volume is that we want to achieve. Okay, this is where it pays for itself right here because we're telling it what storage we need. We're not building it with polylines and then trying to figure out the area that we have, or even using the traditional grading tools that we have in Civil 3D to generate that volume or to generate that pond and then calculate a volume from that. So we know that this pond, when it's done, will be at least 50,000 cubic feet, okay? We are going to set the maximum storage depth, okay, to 4 feet, all right? You can make this whatever you want, all right? We are going to leave this allow boundary change on, okay? What this means is if grading optimization needs to expand this perimeter of the top of the pond or the pond, you know, area itself, it can. We're telling it can, or it can shrink it. All right. That'd be fantastic, wouldn't it? All right. Because we know that every time we have to build detention create a detention pond, the site plans we're given sometimes. It's a 3 acre, 4 acre, 10 acre site, and we've got this tiny 10,000 square foot area. We've got to build detention, right? So this helps us understand very quickly whether we can actually get the volume we need. So we're going to leave this on right now. All right, we're not going to have a safety bench. We're just going to do a dry pond. We are going to set the berm width to 10 feet. we are going to have it calculate a foot of freeboard. Okay. So this foot of freeboard, this can be, I know that this is different. Freeboard's treated differently in a lot of different areas. A lot of times it's a 100-year storm that you're calculating volume for, and then you put a freeboard on top of that. I've seen it to where the freeboard is actually like a 200-year elevation or something like that. So, and it may not be an actual foot, you know, it may be a foot and a half or whatever. You can change that right here before we start. And again, by the way, once we get in the optimizer, you can change all of this information directly in the optimizer also. So the inside slopes of our pond will be at 3, 2, 1. All right. So without further ado, we are going to jump right in to the optimizer. Okay. Now, before I do that, we do have a polyline that's shown right here. And I do want to show you something before we move on. This used to be a elevation offset, all right? That's what this line would be called. Now, we use the elevation offset. It would make more sense. If you have a flat area that you're trying to dig the pond down into, right? This terrain that we're building this on is not really super flat, but if you have a flat area, if you use an elevation offset, it will push the pond down into the ground. Again, that was called elevation offset in 2022, but now in 2023, they changed the name to offset points. So those are it's the same feature. It's just called something different. Okay. And you literally just tell it, you know, the elevation difference is a foot and it will drop that down into the ground. So I just wanted to point that out, because if I'd have said elevation offset, and I probably will say it as I'm used to saying it, I mean offset points. That's what they changed. And you can send all of your letters about being frustrated about that to Charlie and Val. All right.
We have a special email for this, I think.
No? Yes. Yeah, special email. Yeah.
Geo.
We call it great feedback email, right?
Feedback on grading optimization.
All right, so we're going to go ahead and select optimize, and we'll pick our surface, and we'll open up the optimizer. If I can get my toolbar to come up. There we go. All right. Sometimes with Zoom, it opens the window and then minimizes it real quick. So you can see right here, we're showing just our pond. All right. And again, I always like to show this, doesn't matter what I'm trying to grade, I like to show this. If I select the outer limit right there, or just inside this area, this is the properties for my grading limit, okay? And I can change any of that right here. I don't have to go back to Civil 3D, right? That's why it makes iteration so much faster, okay? Is because we don't have to jump back to Civil 3D. We can just make those changes here, run it again. Make changes, run it again, okay? So we'll do that today. You also can see over here in our directory tree that you have a lot of different things going on in this model. But the only things that are on and will be considered are the pond, right? So it's on and it's visible. And we also have our grading limit, which is on and visible. And notice, like I said earlier, we have two grading limits. You can see that the grading limit right here for the pond is on and visible. So we're good to go.
Hey, John, we have three offset points, yeah.
Yes, we do offset points. I'm going to do that whenever I say it. So we do have the GO or the pond offset or offset points set. All right, to on. We have a couple more that are working with the grading on the opposite side over here, but those are shut off, so they will not be considered. All right. Right here under optimization options, you want to be sure that this balance cut and fill is not on. All right. So if it's at zero, it's not going to take into consideration for cut and fill. We're digging a detention pond. You can, by all means, you can have it balanced for cut and fill. If you're in a pretty hilly, like trying to dig it into a hillside, you want to cut it out of the hillside, flip it over and fill, you can do that. In this particular instance, we will not, okay? Because a lot of times, especially if you're in a flat area, it's just going to cut, right? So it's going to try and create fill somewhere else or place that cut somewhere else if you leave the balancing on. So we will leave this off for right now. just being sure that that's set. All right, we're going to go ahead and select optimize. And again, a couple of things while this is going through, you've got the new toolbar down here at the bottom that shows what's going on. And you can see there's a couple different things that's been added. And I talked about them in the new features video that we did for Civil 3D 2023. It goes through and does a pre-check. You also have the notification center right here that tells you if there's an issue with your model right out of the gate, which saves time. So we want to watch this pond. You can see it's generating something pretty nice. All right. I can spin it around and I can look at my convergence plot. Now, it looks like somebody dropped a ping pong ball off some steps, right? It's bouncing, it's bouncing, it's bouncing. Well, we can take a look and just watch this. It's almost getting close to 25,000 iterations and we just started. I'm going to close that for now and take a look at this pond. You can see that we've got a little bit of red here. That's fine. That's going to be because it's not exactly flat, maybe. That's not something that we should worry about. I'll go back and open up the convergence plot again. We can see we're getting closer and closer and closer to our volume. All right, I'll pull this up so you can see it a little better. This is something you want to really watch, okay? The convergence plot tells the story. Right now, it says it's trending towards an optimal solution. We get pretty low here in the graph. So I think I'm probably ready to go ahead and bring it back to Civil 3D. All right. So I can hit stop and simply select send optimized result to Civil 3D or send optimized result. All right. It will come up here. We're going to do two things. We can bring in the surface. And we're going to bring in the feature lines that it reports. We're going to talk a little bit about those feature lines. All right. So we will go ahead and select feature lines. It's just going to dump them into this geo site. You can create a site of its own if you want. You can create a new site every single time that you iterate with a pond or you look at it, if you'd like. You can set the weeding factors just as much like it is inside of the surface modeling tools inside of Civil 3D. So same kind of thought process. So we'll leave those on. We'll go ahead and select our surface and we'll bring that surface in. We'll call it GeoPond 1. Hopefully I don't have one of those. And we'll simply hit finish. And our pond comes in. Now, the next thing I'm going to show you is that it is actually big enough. All right. It did actually do what we asked it to do. It built the pond to 50,000 cubic feet. Here in a second, it will come in.
Need a faster PC, John.
Yes, it's got to be. Should definitely need to talk to my manager about a faster PC, right? I promise you it's Zoom. It always slows it down just a little bit. All right, so our surface comes in. Now remember, our surface hull. Remember we were testing this the other day? I never changed that style back to something that doesn't look like the big blue blob. So we will do that real quick. All right, look a little better. All right, so we can use the surface itself to generate our volumes. It does give us some little bit wonky contours right here using that surface, but I've found that a lot of folks get confused a little bit because it is generating surface out here. It's covering exactly the existing ground. So the surface it's generated is fine, but it is a little deceptive. I say deceptive. That's not what I meant. It's a little confusing because I do see contours out here. Now, what we can do in that particular instance, all right, is I can send the display order of this to the back for my feature line that's there that we will use in a minute and go to my surface itself. And I can add that outer line as a break line, right? And then it chops all that other surface off and we can take a look at it here in the object viewer. Watch closely, Charlie.
Yeah, do that slow.
It does okay. This, right? So that's our surface for actually just creating the surface from grading optimization. Now, I want to do this a little bit different. So I'm going to erase that surface, all right? And I want to send, oh, I'm sorry. I want to create a volume from what was returned feature line wise. So in the new version of 2023, if you, when it returns feature lines, it does something fantastic. All right. So I can select one of those feature lines and it tells me right there what that feature line is representing. Okay. So that's the bottom of the pond. All right. I select the other one, that's the berm inside. So we've gotten gone from the bottom of our pond to the top of our pond, but it's the berm on the inside, okay, that it's returning there. We can continue to move out. It says the berm outside, and then we have, if I send that to the back and pick the right thing, we have our grading limit, okay? That's the grading limit of our pond. So I want to generate a surface just real quick, just so I can show you how this works. We're going to call this pond, and I'm going to add the bottom and the top berm inside to that surface. Just add it as a break line, just like we would any other feature line. And it gives us these nice, beautiful contours, okay? So this can actually be the bottom of your pond. Now, before we run the volume on this, okay, I want to tell you, we've had a lot of questions about, well, what if we wanted to slope the bottom of the pond, right? And have it slope to this corner or however. You can do that. You just create another feature line at the low point and bring it back to however far back you want to come, set the slope on it, and add it to the surface as a break line, and it will generate the bottom of the pond how you like it. Okay, that's one way to do it for sure. All right. So let's take a look at the volume. Now I'm going to run the volume first, how you see it right now. All right. So if I go to design under my analyze tab and I pick stage storage, all right, and I hit define basin. We're going to do it from the surface contours and I pick the surface contours. Okay. So it's 4 foot high, but look at our volume. All right. That's our average end area cumulative. It's at 42,000. Well, that's a red flag, right? Well, grading optimization must have screwed that up. Well, it didn't. Remember that when you're using the stage storage method, all right, or the stage storage feature, it's reading the volumes from the contours, okay? So we're at 1 foot intervals right now. If we shrink that interval, it might get a little better. Don't you think, Charlie?
Yeah, I was going to jump in and say that, but you just did. So.
Oh, well, you can add to whatever I just said. I got excited there. So.
Yeah, it is a stage storage tool, so it's looking at the stages. So the smaller the increment of your stages, the more.
And we're going to put this in at a hundredth of a foot. Now, it's going to be a blue blob. All right.
There's, of course, other ways you could do this, too, but this is probably just a quick way. I mean, you could use the volume dashboard with a flat surface. Just check the volume.
Let's check it again here. All right. And we come down and we want to look at, remember, it figured in the foot of freeboard, right? So if we go to the bottom, well, good grief, it screwed it up again, right? 67,201 cubic foot. I asked for 50,000. Well, remember, it's adding the volume for the freeboard. So we need to drop to 557,288. So let's do that. 557,288. And look at that. 50,453. That's pretty close to 50,000 cubic feet. All right. So if you're wanting to check it to see if it's calculating things correctly, we just, I'll be honest, we went through before we did this session, we hammered on this thing pretty good to be sure that we were telling the truth. And you see right here that we are, all right? So the volumes are correct. I'm going to change that surface style back to our 1 foot interval. All right. Now, I'll go ahead and erase this surface too. And you know what? I'll erase the feature lines too. Didn't erase my pond. All right, so I'm back to my actual pond itself, okay? What we started with. Now, what I want to take you through next is we're going to build a wet pond. I want you to see that. So we're going to go right back into Optimize and select our finished grade surface. We're going to change the characteristics of this pond that we're going to build. We're going to change it right here in the optimizer, okay? We're going to go right back over to our pond and select it, and we have all the properties for our pond, okay? So our minimum storage volume, we're going to leave that alone for right now. We're going to leave it at 50,000. Here in a minute, we're going to show you what it does whenever you have a pond that's much larger and you tell the boundary not to change, okay? So be prepared for that. So the minimum storage volume, we're going to leave it at 50,000. Our storage depth will be 4 feet, okay? And we're going to do a wet pond, all right? Now, Charlie, keep me honest here. So we're going to go to our berm selection first, all right? Actually, you know what? I'm going to back up. We're going to go ahead and tell it to build us a safety bench, okay? Look what happens when we select safety bench. It adds another step down here. We're going to leave the berm the way it is. We want to have the same thing for freeboard, same thing for the berm width. We are going to leave it alone and let it allow boundary change so we can move in and out. We can look at the safety bench, okay? So the safety bench itself and the permanent pool, well, the safety bench itself. What is a safety bench? Some of you may never heard of a safety bench. A lot of municipalities, if it is a deeper pond, so say it's 10 feet deep and it's going to hold water that's 6 feet deep. If it's in a residential subdivision or something like that, that could be a safety hazard, right? It's great for kids to go and fish in. Maybe they aerate it and they can fish or do whatever. But what if they fall into the pond, okay? If they fall into the pond, you want to build a safety bench that's maybe a foot deep and 10 feet wide. That way, they've got to go pretty far out before they actually fall off into the 6 foot deep pond. So they're in a foot of water. Surely they can get up out of that and they're safe, right? Hence the name safety bench. So we're going to leave the safety bench depth at a foot. All right. You can make it whatever you want. Safety bench width. All right. We're going to make that. What did we make that the other day, Charlie? We make it 5 feet, 10 foot. I think we made it 10, right?
I don't remember.
We'll make it 10 feet. And the safety bench slope is 6%. Okay, so the inside of the pond is sloping from the edge of the safety bench down at 3:1. If you're trying to get out of something, and especially water, and it's slick, climbing a 3:1 slope is not fun. So a 6% slope, much, much, much better. You can make the safety bench slope whatever you want. You can make it 2% if you want, all right? Now, we're going to drop down and create or tell it what we want the permanent pool to be. So this is going to be how deep the water is at all times, okay? So the permanent water depth, we're going to make that 4 feet. And the aquatic bench width, we're going to make that, we'll just leave that 5 feet, okay? So again, the aquatic bench slope, that is going to be 6% also. So it's going to kind of tier down. All right, to the bottom of the pond. All right, we've made all the changes that we need to make. Let's take a look at how it optimizes. So we're going to go ahead and select optimize. Goes through the pre-checks. Doesn't give us any errors. All right, and I can take a look at it and see that it's building the different benches, right? You can see them every now and then. They'll come up and there we go, like that right there. It's just going through the iteration process. Notice, again, the convergence plot, okay? It's diving down pretty quickly, right? And that's what we want. It definitely does need more iteration. So we're going to let it iterate just for a little bit. Another thing while that's iterating, one thing, the violation view is the view you start out in now inside of the optimizer. So you can definitely see where you're violating some things. And again, we're only violating the berm slope, which is nothing. It's minimal. So I'll go back to the convergence plot here and we'll take a look at where we're at. It's going to continue. Man, it dropped big there. All right. Just continues to bounce like the ping pong ball. Now, if we're happy with the way the pond looks, so I can zoom in a little tighter. You know, I can see that it's slowing down just a little bit on the berm itself. If I want to, you know, if I want to leave that or stop this at any time, I can. I don't have to wait until the green line starts to show the solution likely. All right. This is, you can let this iterate as long as you want to get the results that you want. Just know that if it doesn't turn green here and it says a solution is likely, that your volume might be a little bit off. Okay. It could be, it might not have met that particular volume constraint that we gave it of 50,000 cubic foot. We're going to test that theory here. We're going to go ahead and stop this here in 1 second. How about right there? Okay. So you can see the top, the safety bench, and then the aquatic berm or the aquatic. I said that wrong, didn't I? Val, this is yours. What do you?
Aquatic bench.
Sorry, aquatic bench.
Where you put the plants on.
Yeah, you put the plants on. All right. So we'll take this back to Civil 3D. Ah, I just hit optimize again. I'm going to try and hit stop. Oh, it actually picked back up. There we go. That's good. Hit send optimized result.
It continues where you left off now.
Ah, is that new in 2023?
Yes.
Perfect. All right. So we're going to bring the same thing in. Actually, you know what? We're not going to bring the surface in this time. We're just going to bring the feature lines in because I like to generate that surface myself with the actual elevations that or the feature lines that I want to pick. Because remember, our volume now is going to be based on the water surface elevation, the constant water surface elevation or the permanent water surface elevation up. Okay. So we need to take into account for that. So I'm just going to bring in the feature lines. We'll leave them where they were before, and it'll bring those in. All right. Now, what do we have here? If you select one of the feature lines, there's the bottom of our pond. All right. Then you have the aquatic bench. Then you have the permanent water elevation. Then you have your bench, your safety bench bottom. All right. Your safety bench top. So it should be 6% across there, right? All right, then you have your berm inside. Now, the question, where do we start? Where do we build our surface out of what feature lines do we pick for our surface? Do we go to the bottom? No, because it's got to have a permanent water elevation because it's a wet pond. So which one of these was that? Because their name.
I know, John.
Oh, do you?
Sure. It's the permanent water level.
Thank you, Val. Val's trying to get points today, so he's got 10 more points than Charlie right now. So we're going to start at the permanent water elevation. All right. So let's build our pond. All right. And just pick the permanent water elevation. Actually, I'm going to pick all of these. And if I remember right, that's the safety bench top. I'm going to pick that, and that. All right. So if you look at it, that's the top of our slope or our top of our berm coming down, down, down. And we stop there at the permanent. So we can select those and hit add to surface as a break line. And voila. Okay. Now, what does that look like? Well, if we take a look at this, and again, here's some more training for Charlie. So if we look at that, you can see it does a very nice job. Just remember, this is the permanent water elevation. All right?
Yeah, for your car doors, you do the whole thing, but you're just looking at storage volumes right now.
Correct. Yeah. It's permanent water. We picked that one, didn't we? I'm pretty sure we did. So let's take a look at the volume. So again, I'll go ahead and change the style back to the hundredth of a foot interval, right? And we will come back to our stage storage and define that pond. So if you look at it, we're going to have a few wonky elevations here at the beginning. Actually, it did a very good job. We'll go back to the top. Look at this. We have 71,000 yards
or a cubic foot down for the freeboard, right?
Yes. So we need to go to 5572.51. Right, and that is right there. And we're at 54,630. So we definitely hit the minimum of 50,000. You can see it's a minimum of 50,000, right? So we want at least 50,000. We have that, okay? If we wanted to move or adjust our grading, let me turn this back. This drives me nuts. Interval back to one. So if we wanted to adjust our pond size, we could. Manually, we can just grip edit the polyline and move it, and that would be fine also. All right, and you could rerun it. So I'm going to delete these feature lines here. Actually, delete that surface. All right.
So
and yes,
John, I got disconnected before. So about the boundary. Did you talk about that?
Yes. We're going to show that right now.
Oh, yes. I couldn't ask the question then.
No. Now go ahead and ask, Val.
John, what happens if I don't let the boundary change and I add a huge volume that won't fit into your polygon?
Well, Val, the new notification center will tell you that it'll give you a notification saying that you can't meet that constraint. And then you'll be able to see, this thing's thinking again. Oh, you'll be able to see, there we go. You'll be able to see that right here in the notification center. So what Val's talking about, and this is the maybe the last thing we'll go through today, is the fact that if you do just like what he said, if you give it a volume it can't meet, and you've told it that you want it to, here we go. You want it to not allow boundary change, okay? I'm going to take the safety bench off in this particular instance, and the berm will be fine. So we're going to toggle that off, and I'm going to make this something silly, all right? 80,000 cubes for 4 feet deep. Well, we know that 50,000 is quite a bit bigger. All right. If we make that change and then we go to run it. All right. And I hit optimize. It will tell us, or we'll have a notification here. All right. It's going to go ahead and try and optimize. Right. So it's going to go back in and look at this, but it's telling us that it adjusted the volume. The new target volume is 51,539, all right? That's because it can't, that's as big as it can get with the constraints that we've given it, okay? We can't hit the 80,000 cubic foot. Now, again, this is a new feature in 2023, the notification center. So very handy. So I could stop right now after I've looked at that and said, well, 51's a far cry short of 80,000. All right, so I could dismiss that and I can either adjust my pond volume here or what would I do, Val?
You let the boundary change.
There you go. We would let the boundary change. We never can questions on these live sessions, by the way. These are all right off the cuff. So
sounded it.
It does, doesn't it? Charlie loves that. So so we can go ahead and hit optimize again, and it will reset. Actually, I probably need to reset that. Nope. You change a parameter, it resets.
Oh, it got bigger.
Yes, you can see the pond is getting bigger. You can see that from our offset points line, it actually kind of moved out just a little bit. All right, we can look at the convergence plot and see where we're at. Get still doing the ping pong ball drop. That's a technical term, by the way. And again, we can watch this thing get bigger, move in and out, do whatever. I'm going to go ahead and stop and send it back to Civil 3D because I want you to see the original polyline that we used, or the original pond polyline that we used, and then see what it returns. So I'll just do them both. Call the surface geopond 7. There we go. And hit finish, and it'll bring that stuff in. Now, that polyline that if I can't move this because it's bringing it in, but if you look at this polyline right here, that represents the bottom of our pond, okay? So, again, Val.
Yeah.
All the time making fun of my machine. He's
the bottom of your pond?
Inferior processors. Do what, Charlie?
You said that polyline's the bottom of your pond?
The polyline's the top of my pond.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, sorry. I said bottom. That's not what I meant. All right, so you can see that things have moved out, okay? So the easiest way to do this is I'll just erase that surface. I just wanted you to see it. So this was the top of my pond where I had it set. This is the berm inside, so it moved it out, okay? It may not have moved it out very much, but it did move it out, okay? So that it could achieve that volume. And this particular, I think we've actually got the aquatic bench in here. There's the bottom. Yeah, the aquatic bench is still shown inside of this pond, which it's a dry pond, right? So it wouldn't have an aquatic bench. But I guess you could still plant your roses and flowers in there, and you just have to come back and water them, right? All right. So as you can see in, 45 minutes or 40 minutes of me talking, how many times we've iterated, how many different ponds we've generated. We've generated 3 different ponds. We've generated a dry pond. We've generated a wet pond with an aquatic bench and a safety bench. We've actually created a pond that was too small, that was not allowed to move in and out, all right, to adjust for that volume that we gave it. And then we brought that back in and showed you the results from that. We also showed you that the quantity numbers that it's figuring are good. They're correct. And again, that was through using the stage storage feature inside of Civil 3D. And remember, it reads the contour volumes or areas, right? So the tighter those get, the better off volume-wise you are. You know, that's probably something that's a good practice. Maybe not so much on mass grading, but you know, it's very easy to change the precision or the amount of distance between the contours in a style. So you could do that on every grading earthwork quantity that you do, and you're going to see the numbers change just a little bit. So, all right, guys, that's what I had to show.
All right. Thanks, John. There are, there were some questions. One of them Val and I answered, but maybe you can just show if you right click on the pond polyline and right click, there's the remove pond option. So someone asked how you can remove the grading object data. So no matter what it is, a zone, a building pad, you can do that, right click and remove it.
Yeah, so I added it right here with the pond, right? And actually, yeah, you add it with the pond or add it. I added it back. But then when you right click and go down, you can select remove pond.
Yeah. And there was another question about in the pond setting elevations instead of depths. The depth might not be known. I think maybe this was about the permanent pool depth. I'm not sure. There are a couple depths in there.
Groundwater, right?
Yeah. So, I mean, right now we did go with depths for everything just because they're all relative to each other. The whole pond could be going up and down, so forcing an elevation could be tricky if the whole pond goes up or below or something.
But you could see the boundary point, right? On the
berm. Yeah, for the berm.
And if you have your maximum storage depth, you kind of use this for where your groundwater is. And that should get you where you want permanent
pool starts. And then have a permanent pool depth below that. Yeah, that's a good point. Certainly the permanent pool might actually be based on an elevation instead of a depth, since it could be relative to groundwater elevations that you already know the elevation, but not necessarily the depth in that case if the pond's going to move up or down. But yeah, Val said could be a way to force it via a certain elevation.
Any other questions?
There was one more, or a couple more, actually, it looks like. Tony asked a few here. So it won't automatically put in retaining walls. You could certainly do that in Civil 3D. And right now, it's really just one slope in each kind of vertical section of the pond, so from the berm down and then inside the permanent pool area, and also the benches, of course. We don't have different slopes for different sides of the pond.
So Charlie, let me ask you something. I'm spitballing this. If you put a retaining wall, okay, let's say it's at the edge of the top of the berm or the top of the pond. If you put a retaining wall grading object there, would it honor that when it was building the pond? Because, I mean, essentially you've got the retaining wall backing up to it. So if it reads the pond, then it reads the retaining wall. And you could, well, can you set, I'd have to go back and look. I mean, that may not work, right?
You don't have priorities for this kind between pond and...
Okay.
But I think since we added retaining wall later, your pond is probably going to be on top of the retaining wall.
Okay. Well, those are new features that can come later. How about that? All this feedback's great feedback because it helps develop the software. It helps develop the tool itself. So
you can build your pond, then you know where your retaining wall is going to be. And if it's outside the berm, it's all going to be fine. You just place one there.
Yep.
And regrade it. And they will work together.
Yep. And yeah, someone agreed entering absolute values, elevations instead of the relative depths makes sense. Someone commenting, stage storage and the grading tool work together automatically. Something we can look into going forward, I guess.
So Tony asked again if you could build a pond with walls around for the wet pond. And yes, I think you can. If you build the pond first, do a first run just having the pond, then you see where the boundary is, if it grows, for example. And then you can just place walls along this boundary and run it again.
Well, I mean, and you can, these are feature lines also, just like any other feature line inside of Civil 3D. So if you wanted a retaining wall, you could just simply select it and offset it. And offset it, you know, a foot for your wall, and then offset it like, I don't know, a tenth of a foot, and tell that to pin to the existing ground surface, and then your walls are done. If it goes around and encompasses the whole grading. You can chop those feature lines too. Sometimes
and if you assign a retaining wall to this offset that you just said, it will only make the wall where it needs to. So where it doesn't need to have a wall, nothing is going to happen. It's just terrain, and it appears where it needs to have a wall. Yeah.
And someone asked what other structures we can make with grading optimization. If you watch the first two sessions, we covered a few of them there, right? So there's a building pad object to kind of represent the slab of a building, flat area elevation that you'd want to set. We can also set or create basically curbs, grading of these objects really is what we're focused on. They're not necessarily BIM objects, but grading for building pads, ponds, curbs, retaining walls, which I don't think we showed and we haven't shown yet. I think that might be in the next one of the upcoming sessions, right? Well, I don't think we showed that in the first two.
No, we didn't.
Yeah.
You just made it.
So stay tuned. That'll be, that'll be coming up. I think that's it for questions here. Guys, right. Any other comments or we good?
Well, I just want folks to, I would encourage you to just take an existing ground surface, draw a shape of a pond, and use geo, all right, or grading optimization. Use grading optimization to grade that pond. All right. You saw how fast we're able to iterate. I'm telling you, I know there's people on, you know, live with us now that have had the instances where it takes you, you know, 2 or 3 hours to size a pond. It can take you more than that just to get the right size and shape of a pond. And the iteration process is very, very slow. All right. Because then if you're doing it manual, you're having to list all of those polylines to get areas and then doing the math yourself and all of that. Even if you're not using the stage storage feature. All right. I've seen folks doing that and didn't know that was there. That right there in itself saves you time. Okay. But the fact that you can iterate so fast and it grades that pond so fast and it gives you the correct feature lines that you can then build off of, right? It's not just grading, contour lines that it gives you or a surface. It gives you the physical feature lines, and then we can continue on out. There's going to definitely be instances, like say if this detention pond was right next to a parking lot, right? The back of curb is here, and the pond starts 2 foot off, right? Well, you could start, the top of the pond is most likely going to set the elevation of the pavement right there that's 2 foot away. So you could offset that top of berm, and you know what elevation you need to start at with your parking or what elevation you need to hit at. And again, you might not even need that feature line elevation because you've already graded your parking lot with grading optimization and included the pond in with it, okay? Definitely want to stress that. If everything that you've seen in the last two sessions, if you go back and look, all of it incorporates together, okay? So they did a parking lot and a building pad and everything Charlie spoke about just a second ago. This pond or a detention pond, if you want to grade it all at once and have it take into account for earthwork, you can do that, all right? You could have 5 ponds that you're calculating at the same time or generating at the same time on the same site, okay? So keep that in mind. You just keep plugging things in and moving up the trail. Sorry, I got on a soapbox there. Had to get my last bit in, right?
John wants to make sure we hit an hour here.
I'm done talking here.
All right, great. Well, thanks everyone for joining. This session will be saved to our channel, so feel free to watch it again anytime. Share it with your coworkers. Also, set your reminders for the next sessions. We have 3 more sessions for this grading optimization YouTube live series. And again, you can find those links to the new ones and also the past ones that we did. The recordings for those are down in the links below under the video. So yeah, thank you everyone again for your time. Thanks to the team here behind the scenes helping us out. Have a great day, and we'll see you again soon. Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.
Bye.
Bye.